Hello class 9, we have already started tissue chapter, and in the tissue chapter I have already explained you about the meristematic tissue and the different types of meristematic tissue and what is the most important characteristic feature of meristematic tissue. It is that it's continuously divides, so it is a dividing tissue. Now today our topic will be about permanent tissue which has lost the capacity to divide. So, can you guess that what happens to the cells that are formed by the meristematic tissue? The cells that are formed by the meristematic tissue, that means which cells that are formed by the meristematic tissue, they will take up some of the specific functions, and after a continuous process of division, they will form permanent tissue and they will lose their ability to divide. So meristematic tissues give rise to cells and they will take up some special features or special functions. Then after some time they will lose their ability to divide and then they will form what? The permanent tissue. So this process in which we can see that the cell is taking up a permanent shape, a size and function, that is called what? Differentiation. So cells of the meristematic tissue will differentiate to form the different types of permanent tissue. So what is the basis of this line is that meristematic tissue can divide and after certain time they will lose the ability to divide and then they will form the permanent tissue. So this role of division and then again losing the ability to divide and converting itself into the permanent tissue with the permanent shape, size and function, this process is called what? Differentiation. So all the cells of meristematic tissue will differentiate to form the different types of permanent tissue. So what we can say in a line, we can represent in a line that meristematic tissue will differentiate and form the permanent tissue. We can write like an arrow diagram, meristematic tissue differentiation, and it will give what? The permanent tissue. This is the most important event in the formation of the permanent tissue. There are two types of permanent tissue, simple permanent tissue and complex permanent tissue. So when the meristematic tissue is converting itself, differentiating itself into the permanent tissue, then they are forming two types, one simple permanent tissue and the second one is complex permanent tissue. Now we will discuss about the simple permanent tissue. These are the few layers of cells which form the basic permanent tissue. The few layers of cell which form the basic layers of the permanent tissue or the packing tissue. This is called what? The simple permanent tissue. Now the name of this tissue is parenchyma. So the basic packing tissue is called the simple permanent tissue, and there, what is the name? It is called the parenchyma tissue. It's also a permanent tissue. And what it will contain? The parenchyma tissue will contain unspecialized cells with the thin walls. The cells are alive and they are loosely packed with large spaces in between the cells. So, in between the cells, there are the structures which are called the intercellular spaces, and the spaces are loose, they are called the large spaces are called the intercellular spaces. So parenchyma cells are unspecialized, they don't have any specialized function, and also they are live cells, they are loosely packed with large spaces between them. They gives a lot of support to the plant. Support and strength are given to the plant by the help of this parenchyma cells. Parenchyma cells that contains chlorophyll are called as chlorenchyma, which helps in photosynthesis. So it will contain what? Chlorophyll. So those parenchyma that will help in the process of photosynthesis, which contains chlorophyll, are called what? Chlorenchyma. And in some aquatic plants, the parenchyma have air cavities in them. so that the plants can easily float in water. So that type of parenchyma is called what? Aerenchyma. You can see the term aeron. That means there are air spaces, and so these cavities are filled with air so that the plant can easily float in water. So there are two types of parenchyma. You can see here, chlorenchyma and aerenchyma. Sometimes the parenchyma of the stems and roots will store the nutrient and water for the use of the plant. Let's come to the next type of tissue, that is the colenchyma. This is also a simple permanent tissue along with parenchyma. The second one is colenchyma. Now the plants are made flexible because of this type of tissue, which is called the chlorenchyma. Now colenchyma will allow bending of the plant. It will allow easy bending of the plant, but will not allow breaking. So this increases the flexibility of the plant. It will allow bending of the plant. You can just bend the branches and also the twigs, but it will not break. Then you have the third point, where it provides mechanical support to the plant. Colenchyma tissues will give support to the plant, helps the plant to stand erect. It will bend, but it will not break. These tissues are found in the leaf stalks, just below the epidermis. There can be colenchyma visible. These are living and they are elongated and thickened at the corners. The colenchyma tissues are thickened at the corners. This is a very important point to be taken care of, because colenchyma tissues, they are thickened at the corners, and that gives flexibility and easy bending to the plants without breaking. And there is very little intercellular space in the colenchyma tissues. What we can see here is very little intercellular space. What is the intercellular space? The space between the two cell is called the intercellular space. So in colenchyma, we can see that there is a very little intercellular space in between the two cells. So in a summary, what we can say that colenchyma tissues are flexible. They are providing mechanical support to the plants. They allow the plants to bend easily, and they provide mechanical and they provide flexibility. They also give strength and support to the plants. They are living cells and they have very little intercellular space. Now I'll show you the diagram of the colenchyma cells from your book itself. As you can see here, number B figure, this is the colenchyma tissues. You can see the corners are thickened. There's a nucleus and this is a vacuole. There's empty place is called the vacuole, and the outer layer, the wall, is called the cell wall. All the plant cell will have the cell wall. We know that. So this is the cell wall. So the thickenings at the corners, just now I told that cellulose, the colenchyma cells are thickened at the corners. So you can see that this is the structure of a colenchyma with very less or no intercellular spaces in between the cells. And in comparison to this figure, you can see in figure number A, this is parenchyma and this is parenchyma, another one with the longitudinal section. This is the transverse section and this is the longitudinal section of the parenchyma. You can see the intercellular spaces in between the cells here. These are the intercellular spaces. Now if you see the longitudinal section, this one, you can see there is a cytoplasm, there is nucleus, there is middle lamella. Here there are chloroplast also, as I told, in chlorenchyma. Then you can see that vacuole. In between the cells there are intercellular spaces and the primary cell wall. So the structures are important for you to understand and practice at home. Next we will come to the next type of tissue. As you can see here, the next type of simple permanent tissue is the sclerenchyma tissue. Now along with this parenchyma and colenchyma, the third one is the sclerenchyma, and this makes the plant tissue hard and stiff. Sometimes some part of the plant is hard and stiff, and that type of tissue is called what? Sclerenchyma. These are mainly the dead tissues, and mostly the shape is like, you know, long and narrow. This long and narrow cells have walls which are thickened due to the lignin. The chemical that is present in the walls is called the lignin, which makes the wall more thickened as compared to the other. So lignin is a chemical substance which will act like a cement, and it will harden. So this hard type of tissue is the sclerenchyma. Why it is hard? Because of the presence of what? Lignin. There's no internal space in between the cells, so no intercellular spaces, where they will be present in the stems, vascular bundles and veins of the leaves, hard covering of the seeds and nuts. You have seen the hard coverings of the seeds and nuts. So here they are present. The seed coats are made up of sclerenchymatous tissue, and you can see that they are the tissues that will provide strength to the plant body. The different part of the plants are supported by and given strength by the sclerenchymatous tissue. So mostly what we got here is that these are the dead tissues which are long and narrow, and the chemical that is present over here is the lignin, which helps in thickening the walls. Okay, and they are present in the covering of the seeds and nuts, also in the veins of leaves, and make these things hard, and also they provide strength. So now I'll show you the diagram from the book itself. See, here you can see the figure number C. This is sclerenchyma, and this is number 1 is the transverse section, and this is the longitudinal section. Now you can see here it is written lignified thick wall. That means what? They are made up of lignin. The wall contains what? Lignin, which helps in thickening and making the part hard. So these are long at the ends, you can see here, tapered at the corners and with the thick wall. So you can see the diagram. Let us see what is present in the outermost layer of the cells. The outermost layer of the cells. So many layers of cells are present to make the tissues that we have already discussed. So after, you know, 4 or 5 layers, so we can see that what is present in the outermost layer. Some will be after 4 or 5 layers of cells. There will be some outer layer, some inner layer, some middle layer, like this. So what is the outermost layer called? The outermost layer is called the epidermis. So you can see that the outermost layer is epidermis, which is made up of single layer of cells. So in epidermis, what will happen? How the cells are arranged in a single layer of cells. And what is the function? They will protect the inner parts of the plant. So epidermis is a protective tissue that is formed in the outermost layer, and sometimes it may be thicker also, so that the water loss is reduced. So mostly epidermis will have this type of functions, like preventing the water loss, protecting against any sort of injury to the plant, and protecting the plant from any sort of fungal infection. This epidermis layer is a very important. It will protect all the parts of the plant body which is present in the inner surface. And sometimes these epidermal cells will also protect the plant from any sort of fungal infection, because they are quite thick, and they are often secreting some waxy substances which will make the cells or tissues water resistant. So it will not allow the water to directly seep inside, because it will form a waxy layer which is shiny like a wax, and then it will prevent the water to enter inside, so it will make it waterproof. Okay, so these are the characteristic features of epidermis. The outermost layer of the tissue in the plant cell is called the epidermis, which protects the plant parts which are present inside. The epidermis will protect the different parts of the plant cells. Next, we can see that mostly the epidermis, you can see this diagram I have tried to shown you here, that the cells are like this, more or less, which are flat, and the flat epidermal cells, they are having some pores, openings that are visible here, which are called the stomata. So some of the epidermal cells that we can see here, I have tried to draw here, they will have some spores here and there, and these spores are called what? Stomata. Some openings, spores are what? Openings. Some spores may be present here and there, which are called the stomata. And the stomata are guarded by two kidney shaped cells, which are called the guard cells. You all know this, stomata and guard cell. What is the function of stomata? They helps in giving out the excess water from the plant, that in the form of transpiration. So the process by which the water is lost from the leaves in the form of water vapor, that is called what? Transpiration. So the stomata are present, which are guarded by this two kidney shaped guard cells. And this stomata helps in transpiration and also helps in exchange of the gases, because this is the opening which is regulated by the guard cell. Opening and closing of stomata is regulated by the guard cell. So this will help in exchange of gases and also helps in transpiration, that is loss of the water in the form of water vapor. And sometimes in the roots also we can see that the epidermal cells. So some of the epidermal cells in the roots also will extend, and this side I have drawn one root here. So the epidermal cells of the roots, this will help in water absorption. They will have what? Root hairs present, which will increase the area of absorption. So all this that we have seen here are the functions of the epidermal cells. Which is the most important function of the epidermal cell is protection and also prevention of water loss. In the roots, they will help in increasing the surface area for the absorption of the water. Okay. Now sometimes we can see that in some desert plants, the epidermis has a thick waxy coating, which is made up of cutin, the substance that is waterproof, and this is present in the desert plant so that the water loss is very less. This thick waxy coating that is present above the epidermis, which is made up of cutin, is waterproof. So it will not allow the excess water in the desert plants to go outside in the form of water vapor, so that the plant can hold a lot of water inside, because desert plants will not get enough water, so they have to be waterproof. So this is the process, that is a layer of cutin is present, which makes it waxy and thick, and then it will not allow the excess water to pass out. So as you can see here, the waxy coating contains the cutin, which is waterproof. And the older plants, what happens in the older plants, the epidermis of the stem is replaced by the secondary meristem. The outermost layer of the plant body is called what? The epidermis. And this epidermis is replaced by the secondary meristem in the older plants. And slowly what happens? The cells on the outside are cut from this layer. And this forms what? The cork or the bark of the tree. In the trunks of the bigger trees, you can see brownish layer, which is very thick, which are called the bark of the tree. This bark is the outermost layer, which is made up of the dead cells. So these layers are formed by the secondary meristems, which replaces the epidermis of the stem. And these dead cells are also present in the cork. There are no intercellular spaces, and there is a chemical which is called suberin, which is present in the dead cells of the cork, which is impervious to gases and water. It does not allow the gases and water to go inside and outside. This is impervious or impermeable. Does not allow the movement of the gases and water through these layers of cork. Okay, so today we have discussed about the simplest form of the permanent tissue, that is simple permanent tissue, and in the next lecture we will be discussing about the complex permanent tissue. Hope all of you have followed this lecture. Please try to go through the video once and try to understand each and every point that has been described here. So in the next lecture we will be doing the complex permanent tissue, and you just go through the video so that you can understand each and every point. If you want, you can jot down the points from the video itself.